All right, so just while we wait, I'm going to just introduce myself. I'm Pablo, some of you know me already, and this is Kate Spanos, I'm Pablo Regis. And we run EducArte, which is education and arte. And we've come in a lot of Latin events. Right now our focus is on Brazilian music. And we partner with College Park's College Park Arts Exchange, which is run by Melissa Slice over there. And on doing this event, it's the first in a four-part lecture series that is funded by the Maryland Arts, Maryland Humanities. And so we want to thank them and College Park Arts Exchange. And our guest today is Tom Rohde, who's a scholar and also a musician who practices the genre that we're about to talk about. He kicks off the first one, and we're going to have, there are information for the dates is on our website, but we have three more lectures after this, focusing all on different aspects of Choro, which is really Brazil's first instrumental genre, sort of Brazilian, you call it instrumental music or jazz music or whatever you like. But we're kind of taking it somewhat in chronological order. So Tom's talking about and European in Brazil, and then we'll have a later series talking about, you know, more about African aspects, more about more modern ties of it to like modern Brazilian jazz. And then I'll let Tom do it. But I just want to ask each one of you, like, how did you hear about the event? I know some of you are on the list, sir, so you know about it. Did anyone else hear about it through our newsletter or social media?
Mailing list. I'm on your mailing list.
Oh, great.
Great.
And you?
I have just Googled Choro DC.
Cool. That sounds great. Well, great.
So if you Google DC Choro, actually you'll find the band that Pablo was in for many years.
Okay. Yeah. Choro DC, we have a Facebook, I don't know if we have a webpage anymore. But actually two of the lecturers, Brian McCann is next. He's the head of the history department at Georgetown. And Annie Connell was an ethnomusicologist at George Madison, James Madison. They were also part of that band. We all started many years ago at Georgetown. We since don't have a band, but they're part of the lecture series as well. So
awesome.
Yeah.
And what made you Google Choro DC?
I sort of found music and then I wanted to listen to it.
Cool.
Great.
Awesome.
Welcome, David.
Great.
Cool.
And nothing was in the number to describe.
Yeah.
Bachelor. It's a pleasure. It's a Brazilian music is something I've been very involved in for over 25 years now, and in different settings. I've played a lot of choro in my life. And is anyone here familiar with choro? I know David. You guys are. And, you know, too. Yeah. So we're going to talk a lot about the early history of choro, and in other lectures we'll talk about more of the more things that come after that in chronological order. So I'm going to focus a lot on developments in the 19th century and then to the early 20th century when choro crystallized as a musical genre. So choro is also affectionately referred to as chorinho by many Brazilians, and it can be defined as a traditional and primarily instrumental Brazilian popular music genre. Choro developed in Rio de Janeiro during the mid to late 1800s as a result of mixing the popular European musical genres, such as the polka and the waltz, with Brazilian rhythms and forms, such as the batuque and lundu. By the late 1800s, choro then crystallized into a distinct musical genre. Then throughout the 20th century and beyond, a series of innovations and contributions by many outstanding musicians led to the establishment of a very rich repertoire. So that's very full of acoustic instruments and lots of variety in terms of rhythms. Choro can be played in a variety of settings, such as backyards, cafes, bars, at parties, in dance halls, jazz clubs, theaters, concert halls. Any of those settings are possible places where the choro could be played. So it has a lot of versatility. Its performance context has changed over time. Choro is a communal and conversational music. It is frequently played in a format called the roda de choro, and this is the roda de choro right there. A roda de choro is basically a circle jam session. These choro jam sessions are frequently referred to as rodas, or a roda, where, technically speaking, anyone, meaning those who have the ability to play the music, can join in. Rodas may be organized or planned, or they may be impromptu jam sessions. It just depends on the musicians. But it is in the roda setting where the language of choro is learned by musicians. It creates an opportunity for those who are also new to the genre to learn about it and play with experienced choro musicians. In addition, the roda creates a sense of community. It creates a forum for musicians to play together, which fosters a larger sense of community. And so anyone that has played choro realizes that and has participated in the roda. So if you have any desire to learn choro, that's where you want to go to learn it. And also to connect with other players, and then you get a lot out of it. I want to show you a scene from this movie that I have here. And it's this movie is called Brasileirinho. Brasileirinho means Little Brazilian, but is also a choro tune. And this is a documentary of choro in Brazil. If I can get this to work, just give me 1 second. Let's pop up here for 1 second and restart. So if you haven't seen this movie, I highly recommend it. It's a great introduction. It's not going to be as thorough with some of the historical stuff, but it gives you a great introduction to the players, what their perspective on the music is, and so it's pretty neat in terms of that. So here's a typical roda de choro.
jazz brasileiro. O jazz, a pessoa toca, faz o solo e depois sai improvisando.
So here they are listed here. Basically any combination of these instruments and other ones that we've seen are fair game within choro. At certain times, certain ones were used more frequently in certain settings, but flute, clarinet are common. The Brazilian mandolin called the bandolim is used. Of course, we saw a trombone there. You could see various ranges of saxophones, the trumpet. There's this other instrument called the afflatus that's obsolete now. It's kind of in the tuba family that used to be used in the 19th century and into the early 20th century. You can hear strings sometimes in choro, piano for sure. Then these are some of the plucked string instruments, with the exception of the last two. So you may have noticed that there was a guitar with extra strings that was called the seven-string guitar, or the violão de sete cordas. Regular classical style guitars are called the violão, and then cavaquinho is the small steel string ukulele. Nowadays, the violão uses nylon strings, but before World War II, they used to use steel strings. And then some of the seven string players would even put like a cello string on the lowest bass string, just to give it a little, a bigger sound, and they'd have to modify the guitars a little bit. Cavaquinho uses steel strings still. Piano is used, just depends. Sanfona or accordion is used pretty frequently. And then percussion is something that we'll talk about. It was integrated into the choro bands and recordings in probably the 1910s, 1920s, around that time, and became more of a regular thing through the influence of the samba primarily. So those are some of the choro instruments. This is an early guitar called the viola caipira. It's still played. It's called, referred to as a country guitar. You hear this instrument accompanying vocal works, songs, etc. So it's pretty much used for that. But here are the main instruments in the choro ensemble. So we have our guitars, we just mentioned the seven strings, the regular six string classical, the mandolin, flauta, which is the flute, cavaquinho, and then the main percussion instrument used pretty frequently in choro is the pandero, which looks like a tambourine but doesn't function like one. You have to hit it with your hands, it's a special technique. So you'll see all of those being integrated into the ensemble. Okay. Push on over here. The early choro groups in the late 19th century tended to be trios or terns. They were trios of flute, cavaquinho, and guitar. And they were prevalent, from the late 1800s and into the early 20th century. And then these other instruments started to come in and be added into them. But sometimes you hear that format too. It's flexible. It hasn't gone away quickly. But that's the core group. And then in the 1920s and 30s, the banner ensemble expanded to the conjunto regional, or the regional ensembles. And these were the professional groups. So a lot of the players in choro groups before the 1920s were a mix of levels, performance levels. It just depended on who they were. A lot of them were like civil servants and sort of amateur players, but could play well. When we get into the 1920s, we start to get the era of radio, and then we get after that, of course, actually before that, there was recordings going on there too. So we have recordings and radio happening. So these conjunto regionais, these professional groups developed and then really brought the level of playing up to quite a bit. So that's just some contextual information about those groups. Now, rhythmic styles, some common rhythmic styles of choro. Of course, there's the choro itself. There's all these other names that have all these derivations and influences. Mashishi, waltz, samba, and then other northeastern regional rhythms. Frevo, baião, schottische, ijexá. A lot of them have various levels of European or African influence being integrated into them and part of their development. Another thing about some of these rhythms, rhythmic concepts within Choro is we hear a lot of not only repeated rhythmic ideas in terms of patterns, but then we hear lots of breaks and stops that kind of create excitement and variety in the music, but also help mark sections, transitions, beginnings, endings, things of that nature. So I did say that Choro is primarily an instrumental genre, but sometimes it is sung, not often, but once sometimes it is. And so during the 1920s, 30s, etc., Choro groups, the conjunto regionais, accompanied singers for recording. So they accompanied samba singers all the time, and they just improvised their accompaniment. And so they would accompany all these styles, samba, the samba canção, which developed more in the 1930s, certainly Choro pieces. If you ever heard of Carmen Miranda, she sings Choro in those Hollywood movies and in samba too. Waltzes, valsa, mojinha, and lundu. I'll talk about these a little more. And so all these other genres are potential vocal styles that could be sung with the accompaniment of a Choro group. So the really importance of the Choro group, besides cultivating a musical style, they also cultivated a musical language that became a staple of Brazilian music for years to come. So in terms of instrumentation, in terms of musical vocabulary, in terms of how the instruments relate to one another, so it's really a core feature or the heart of Brazilian music, so it's pretty interesting in that sense. All right. I'm going to allow questions at various points throughout the discussion. So before I talk about some of the basic core components, are there any quick questions right now? Everybody good? Okay. All right. All right, so the basic musical elements of Choro. So I'm just going to go over a couple basic things for those who aren't familiar. That's why I'm going over the instruments. And then I'll get into more historical context. And then we'll listen to some examples after, through that process too. So, Choro, so the melody, let's talk about the melodies. Melodies tend to be busy in Choro. They tend to have a lot of drive, they tend to be virtuosic. A lot of this comes from the fact that the players that were playing the melodies were classically trained and were sometimes conservatory trained and grew up in a strong musical atmosphere. And so they played very virtuosic as a result. So the music has a lot of drive from that. Also, there are a variety of musical influences that are going into this as well that we'll talk about throughout today's presentation. Constant driving 16th notes, wide leaps, really things that are not only catchy, but also hard to play. So it's very, very demanding in terms of its style. There are influences not only from classical music, but also from the genre of Italian opera, which was very popular during the 19th century and into the early 20th century. And then there are also a lot of lyrical melodies too in Choro. Not only are they virtuosic and catchy, but there's also some very beautiful melodies that are in the genre. So there's nice variety within that. And there's also variety in the tempos. Some Choros are slow, some are medium paced, some are really fast, some are very fast. So we're gonna hear all that. So there's no requirements, about that. It's just, based on the piece and the player and those types of things. I want to talk about this concept of counterpoint, and I want to show you an example. So counterpoint, from a theoretical standpoint, is a combination of two or more minds that work with one another, but according to a set of theoretical rules. So counterpoint is an important element of Choro, and it also has been strongly cultivated in classical music. And one of the things that a lot of people might not realize about Brazilian culture is it was kind of stuck in the Baroque era in terms of the music until about 1808 or so, beginning of the 19th century, when the Portuguese court came and kind of started to modernize things. So the musical language, that contrapuntal thinking and musical style is really a core part of the music making that was going on. Of course, improvisation was part of it too, oral tradition. So these players, you're gonna hear them, they're trained, but they're also gonna use their ears in this. So I got a little excerpt illustrating some of the counterpoint in Choro. That's not it.
Oh. Estamos.
Está na sua hora?
É. Está terminando?
A pessoa toca, faz o solo e depois sai improvisando, o estilo americano. E o nosso estilo, que é no caso o choro, fazemos também, tocamos a primeira, a segunda parte, a terceira parte. Quando voltamos, voltamos também com improviso, quer dizer, uma coisa que você toca criando. Está sempre criando uma coisa em cima daquilo que já foi feito ali.
Zé da Velha, ele faz muito contracanto, entendeu? Ele é o rei do contracanto. Depois de Pixinguinha, só o Zé da Velha faz contracanto desse jeito. E eu aprendi muito com o Zé essa coisa de tocar. Um faz a melodia e o outro inventa outra melodia. Então fica um diálogo muito interessante. E a coisa do instrumento de bocal lembra muito aquelas Big Band. Maurício Carribe definiu bem a nossa dupla. A menor Big Band do mundo. Essa música ela não tem idade. Uma roda de choro tem um de 70, um de 15, um de 40. Essa música é como se fosse uma comunhão. Choro é uma comunhão, porque todo mundo comunga daquela coisa boa, né, que já vem há mais de um século. Isso é fantástico.
So the waltz, especially the Chopin waltz, was very, very popular in Brazil during the 19th century and beyond. And the choro takes some of that form and, you know, adopts it. And so we see these, you know, nice clean phrases. But then the Chopin waltz form, this section of sense of, we have this A section of music and then a B section, and then the A comes back. Then we have another section called the C section, and the A comes back again. That's referred to as a type of lundu form, if you will. Creates cohesion in the work and also variety. So a lot of choros, you really follow this pretty strictly. So if you, you know, understand that, then you're good to go. It also follows the modulation patterns typical of Chopin waltzes. But, you know, they don't sound like Chopin waltzes. They could, I guess they're influenced by it. They're influenced by it harmonically, but then music has a different rhythmic aspect to it. Okay, pushing on. Some other basic elements of choro, we have the center or the chordal accompaniment, usually played by the cavaquinho, the ukulele, and then the guitar can also play that too. And then, a lot of the chords that are used have this thing called inversion, where a note other than the root might be bass, and this creates these descending and ascending kind of bass lines and gives them drive and direction to the music, and also create a very rich sound. So it's very reminiscent of the Romantic period or the 19th century in terms of classical music. So rich, full, lush chords, lots of major sixth and seventh chords of all types, so that all that is being integrated, and then we have this beautiful counterpoint woven into all that texture. The bass lines, you may have noticed in this music, are pretty prominent and pretty active. you know, on the seven string guitar or any low instrument can play these melodic bass lines called Bachelor. This is like low singing, you know. So they're usually improvised, but basically a vocabulary is established not only for the style, but on a tune by tune basis as well. And so that helps really drive the music. So it's a really important part of it, you know, to have the melody and that bass line interacting. Improvisation, they were talking about in the video a little bit. There's lots of improvisation. There's improvising a counterpoint, for sure. There's improvising, you know, even just a little bit, say if you're playing an accompaniment pattern. Choro tends to, like many traditional styles, be pattern-based, meaning the patterns repeat over and over throughout the tune. But within that framework, there's lots of improvisation. Notes can be added or taken away and suggested, and it just depends on what's going on with the leading strings, the melody, etc. And so there's a dialogue happening even with the accompaniment part. So every part, you know, has its importance and it has its role within the texture. Improvisation, we heard in that Choro de Choro, especially in Choros, there's this kind of collective improvisation type of concept going on. So lines going all over the place, but hopefully enhancing one another. In Choro, a lot of cases, improvisation does not dominate the composition. It is used to enhance it instead of, like in American jazz, where sometimes, especially after like the 50s, you know, sometimes the improvisation became the focus of the composition. In Choro, that tends not to be the case. There are exceptions to that, of course, but by and large, improvisation is a traditional thing where the players enhance the melody, and then, like they were saying, sometimes on repetitions of sections, say like when you have all these A sections coming back, players might, you know, throw in some variations. So you hear a lot of that going on. It's pretty interesting. And they tend to use very classical style embellishments and trills and things of that nature, things that you would hear maybe in the Baroque period. The rhythm in Choro tends to be in 2-4, which is, it comes from the influence of the march and the polka. So we hear a lot of pieces in 2-4, so like the bulk of the repertoire is in 2-4. You know, but some are in 3-4, like in waltz, you know, rhythm or meter. And then there's some other meters that could be in there as well, depending on, you know, the piece, the rhythmic style it's adapting from, etc. Okay. Any questions on any of that? Good? So moving on, some early Brazilian musical forms. So now we're going to look at the various designations for Brazilian rhythmic styles and musical forms that were developing during the 19th century and influenced the Choro. So these were cultivated in Brazil. These and some other ones we're going to talk about, as a result of a variety of social, cultural, economic, and political circumstances. And some of this was complicated, such as colonialism, and then slavery, and then throughout the 19th century, there was a lot of immigration, and also importation of foreign products. And so all of this, you know, led to cultural mixing and lots of, you know, changes over time. So, Batuque is the general term for Afro-Brazilian percussion and jam and dancing. So the early Batuques were very generically just thought of as, you know, African influenced dancing with percussion. And through this term, we get the term batucada, which is Brazilian percussion jam. So you hear that in carnival, and you hear that in various contexts where percussion is the feature, meaning all the other instruments we've listened to so far are taken away. So let's see. And a precursor to the modern urban samba, it was the samba de roda, similar to the roda de choro, right? It's performed in a circle, but this is a traditional Afro-Brazilian circle dance in song form, and it features lots of hand clapping and lots of percussion in a circle. It sometimes has guitar accompaniment, sometimes it doesn't, it just depends. And it usually just has like two chords if it does. And this has lots of singing and lots of, you know, dance featuring. So it's a, you know, very impromptu traditional type of thing that developed. And so this influences Brazilian popular music. And you hear instances of it from, you know, from time to time. Now, going to the flip side of things, the Mauginia. So, Mauginia is more European in terms of its sound, but we'll talk about this a little bit. So, the Mauginia is a Brazilian sentimental song genre. It was typically accompanied by guitar in the earlier days during the late 18th century. Into the early 19th century, it was accompanied by the viola caipira that we saw in an earlier slide. And it was maintained through oral tradition initially. And so then it was adopted into the salon genre, as a salon genre. Interesting too is the genre combines learned European poetry combined with these improvised guitar parts and accompaniments, and represents this merging of the oral musical practices with written poetic traditions. From the Mauginia, the Choro gets some of its sentimental and expressive qualities. So it's very beautiful, heartbreaking stuff. And then, you know, the Mauginia influences the canzone, and then the samba canzone too, that became popular, a lyrical, sentimental, lush, romantic style of music. A cousin of the Mauginia, and I'll explain why in a minute, is the lundu. So, the lundu, it initially started as a variant of the batuki, but it's also related to the Mauginia in a way. It was originally an Afro-Brazilian dance, and it became, later on, a popular song genre that combined African rhythms with the European-style harmonies. Basically, both the Mauginia and the lundu were performed by serasteiros, or serenaders, who were people that walked around the town, and they were homeless, whatever they could be, but they would play at street corners and at parties and in bookstores and cafes and in all these different places. They would play for money, they play for food, whatever. And so they played both Mauginias and lundus, and they were common during the late 18th and throughout the 19th century. So the reason why Mauginia and lundu are influenced because those serasteiros are playing both of those styles of music. And so the Mauginia and lundu are, once they're adapted, some of the earliest popular music in Brazil. So it's pretty interesting. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a little bit. Now, the lundu, this little bit down here, pretty interesting. So the lyrics tend to be on Afro-Brazilian topics, and they use lots of colloquial language. There's lots of sarcasm, humor, and also social and political commentary, similar to the modern day pagode, so in that sense. So the lundu was that the vehicle for that type of expression. Mauginia was not about anything real. It was always about love and fantasy and all these interior things. So the lundu was more exterior, and the Mauginia was just more intimate. So interesting in terms of that. And I'm going to get back to that in just a little bit. I'm just going to go over some genres that are really prominent during the 19th century. The waltz. So the waltz is a dance in three, and it was really popular during the 19th century throughout Europe, throughout the Americas, and because it was a ballroom dance, and there were ballroom dances that were popularized in Paris, France especially, and so anything that became really popular in Paris had a tendency to find its way to Brazil or other countries in the colonized world, and including the United States. So the waltz is really important. It became one of the most influential genres of the 19th century. It influenced every bit of music, every genre, whether it's traditional folklore, classical, popular, you name it. Everyone was cultivating the waltz in some way, shape, or form. So the very first piece we heard today with that trio of people playing, they're playing a waltz. It's a fast waltz. So not all waltzes, in the Choro genre are slow. Like many of them are these slow, lyrical, beautiful pieces. some of them are fast like that. It's not the Romanian ones. So that's the, you know, the waltz. And, you know, the waltz obviously has this 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And there's a specific set of dance moves, you know, developed in the ballroom setting. A couple of other rhythms that are influential on the choro, the polka is very influential. So the polka is a lively couple's dance in 2-4. It has this kind of a syncopated kind of feel to it where it goes boom, cha, boom, cha, boom, cha, boom, cha, cha, boom, 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 boom. So that feel grafted really nicely on some of the, you know, African rhythms that were prevalent in Brazilian music already. And so they, you know, when that was mixed, we started to get these new formations of rhythmic forms. So the polka becomes popular in Paris and then is brought to Brazil. So about by mid-1800s. And so then we're going to see that many of the choro composers call their early choro compositions polkas, you know, because it was so prevalent, although they had a different feel to them as compared to the European polkas. Another genre related to polka is the schottische. The schottische was, this is a, first of all, it's the German word for Scottish. And it is a rhythm that came from Germany, and then it was disseminated everywhere. So they had them, you know, in the United States, through Central America, like every country like adopted some version of this. And then, but there's also an equal number of variety, I guess, in terms of how that genre was adapted and cultivated in different places. So a schottische in the United States might sound different than Brazil or, you know, somewhere else. So it's pretty interesting in that sense. So we have this, you know, all these genres cultivated, you know, bare settings and then imported. Another rhythm, the habanera. So the habanera, you probably would know it as an Argentinian tango if you heard it. So it's dun, da boom, 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 da boom, boom. So that would be the habanera. Interesting, the habanera developed in Cuba, but it developed as a result of the contradanza being imported into Cuba by Frenchmen from both Haiti and Louisiana, and they converged in Cuba, and then with the African-Cuban influence there, that became the habanera, brought back to France, then brought to Brazil. So basically, that's how that worked. This musician, for instance, Henrique Alves de Mesquita, you know, he's credited as being one of the first to to take that habanera rhythm from from France, because he studied at the Paris Conservatory, and then he comes back, and then this is one of the pieces he writes. Let me just sorry, that kind of stuff, and let me just see if I can pull this up here. Second, third. Thank you. first, but you know, there are plenty of other musicians exposed to it at the same time, so it's coming in. Yes?
So, why did it sound like Carmen in the beginning?
Oh, because, want to know why? So, in Carmen the Opera, that music was not Spanish, it was Cuban.
Oh.
And in the habanera that they used was you know, taken from a Cuban source and not even Spanish. That particular one, there's other music in that opera that's Spanish. Uh-huh. Yeah, so that's why. And it's called the habanera because it, you know, it's exactly that rhythm. So that's a good observation. Yeah, because they weren't worried about authenticity. they were concerned with exoticism. So that develops. So we have the polka going, and then we have the habanera, and that leads to the schottische, which has a very similar type of rhythm going on. So this emerged in the late 1870s. There was a dance that went along with it, where the couples were danced very close, and it was very scandalous because it was, that wasn't supposed to be allowed. But anyways, people loved it, and this developed into the modern urban ensemble. So a lot of the early pieces that we'll hear are schottisches, and I'm going to play some in a little bit when I get into this. Okay, so those are the main forms that are at work in influencing one another and at play during the 19th century. Okay. And then I have a little bit here on the Mojinha in Portugal. And this is some interesting material here. Basically, the Mojinha is brought from Brazil to the courts of Portugal by Domingos Carlos Barbosa. And he popularizes it in the courts. And so he's singing lundus and Mojinhas. He's playing on the viola caipira and accompanying himself, but integrating a very strong sense of European poetry into his style. So it's pretty interesting in that sense. And a lot of the documented history of Brazilian popular music starts with Domingos Carlos Barbosa, mostly because there's no other documentation. One thing people don't realize about Brazil is there was no printing allowed, there was no cultivation of reading, so it was a highly illiterate population. So, Carlos Barbosa learned his Mojinhas and lundus in the streets of Rio and through the oral tradition, and he brought that, to the courts of Portugal, and they were all fascinated with it. And but one thing that the Mojinha adapts are neoclassical poetic, themes, pastoral themes in those types of subjects, lots of references to the past and in past times. So that becomes some interesting things that become part of the poetic realm of Brazilian music. Again, there were chorus that had lyrics attached to them, and some of the these poets over time contributed to that repertoire. This Mojinha that developed in Portugal was then brought back to Brazil. So in 1808, the Portuguese royal court picked up and moved, probably about 10,000 people from the court to Rio to evade the Napoleonic invasions. And so they established this whole culture in Rio. And through this Portuguese royal court being in Rio, they brought European culture with them, music, a lot more classical music. And so all of that was something that was integrated into what was going on in Rio at the time. So one of the influences that starts to develop as a result of their presence, but then this increased awareness of European culture is Italian opera. So Italian opera, it's interesting, like some of the Mojinhas that were being printed during maybe 1830 to 1850 or 60, some of them have themes from Italian opera. So some of them are taking, you know, music of Rossini, music of Bellini and Verdi, and this in integrating them, calling them homogeneous, but having all this operatic style to it. And some of it quotes directly, maybe transposed. Of course, they'll put new poetry on it, Portuguese poetry in some cases, and call them homogeneous. And so the Mogenia took on some strong Italian operatic influences through the presence of all this virtuoso singing that was part of Italian opera that also influences the Choro. So we have a strongly lyrical style. So the Italian opera is very lyrical. Lyrical means song-like and easy to sing and memorize, right? So all of those things are, you know, incorporated into the popular music of the time. And so basically the same musicians that would play lundu and Mogenia would be the same ones that were starting to develop choro. But I'm going to talk about the variety of context in a little bit. All right, another instrument that comes along with the Portuguese royal court is the piano. So the piano, yes, there were some harpsichords and there were some keyboards in Brazil before the Portuguese royal court. And I said there's a strong Baroque music influence. So that was definitely something that was present in Brazil. But then we see real pianos being brought to Brazil throughout the 19th century. So in fact, in 1856, this writer named Araújo Porto Alegre dubbed Rio de Janeiro as the city of pianos because there are so many pianos that were available in the city. The presence of these pianos also encouraged the performance and popularization of European musical styles, especially the waltz and the polka. And then also we had mogenhos or lundus were being printed. And you know, those stylistic qualities that I had talked about being part of that music were in the printed versions as well. And so people were reading the stuff, they were playing it at home, you know, they were singing them at home. They were targeted for a, you know, middle class, more amateur type of musician. So all this starts to become available. So one of the things that the Portuguese royal court brings to Brazil is printing. And you know, at first, you know, after they allowed printing to start to take place, the Brazilian printing industry took decades to get going. So that required importation of both music and also literary sources. And guess who was the biggest supplier? France. So there was a huge influx of French culture via, you know, these literary sources and then music. So whatever the French wanted to give them, that's what they got, you know. And so that led to this huge French influence. There are French newspapers. And then so when Brazil started printing, most of the authors were so entrenched and immersed in French literary culture that they just started imitating it and then just, you know, writing in Portuguese versions of everything else. They take the stories that they, you know, read in the newspapers. You know, they had the newspaper serials that were written. And an interesting thing about the newspapers in Brazil and the journals, they're printing things and they're affordable, they also produce music. They had standard notation, pieces and standard notation in there, and people would take them and start playing them. So they'd have mogenhos and lundus and, you know, other types of pieces, polkas and stuff. So because of, you know, you send out, you know, 1,000 copies of that, everyone's going to start playing it, and that becomes influential. So the printed page becomes very influential in Brazil. So this is how all this, you know, European influence just floods, you know, the market, especially in urban areas. You know, and this is, you know, we're focusing on Rio because this is the, you know, where all this cultural importation is happening. So it's a pretty interesting process. Meanwhile, while people are playing this stuff, there's still a hugely illiterate population. There are still lots of musicians, most of them that play through oral tradition, especially the guitarists and singers and things like that. So they heard this music, opera, waltz, polka, you name it, imitated it, and then put their own spin on it, and then that's how they started developing these more distinct, you know, distinctly Brazilian styles. So it's a pretty interesting process, you know, there. Okay, any questions right there before I move into the next bit of talk? Good? Okay. So here are some music groups that developed. So I talked about the sextetos, and I talked about, you know, amateur music making in various contexts. And there was certainly opera, there was theater, there were classical music concerts, there was church, there was organ, you know, all that kind of stuff, choir singing, all those types of things. The folklore music, the African, you know, the music that the slaves cultivated, African religion, the Afro-Brazilian religious music, candomblé, mamba, all that music is in the air, okay? So everyone's, you know, hearing that, and it's a huge influence. And Brazil had so many more times the number of slaves that we've had in the United States during the time. I don't know what the numbers are, but maybe 4 or 6 times more, and that resulted in a huge African influence in terms of the music. So that's being integrated. Now, let's look at these ensembles that were developed. One is called the Choro Maleros, and they were a terno ensemble, flute, cavaquinho, and guitar, combined with wind instruments. And so they play just popular music of the day, whatever they could get a hold of, whether they played it by ear or sheet music, you know, just whatever they could do. There were barbers, you know, barbers that worked in barbershops. They had little ensembles. So these are just amateur ensembles. This last one is pretty interesting too, fazenda band. So fazenda in Brazil were plantations, usually worked by slaves and had plantation owners. So the plantation owners would, in some cases, organize slave orchestras or slave ensembles. And so these musicians were taught, you know, European types of instruments, they were taught to sight read, they, you know, they had all this skill, but they also were from this African-Brazilian tradition and integrated those rhythmic ideas, the interpretation, the feel, all that type of thing into the music. So all this cross-cultural mixing going on in Brazil. So that's, you know, these are the things that make Brazilian music so rich and led to the formation of these great musical styles that we're studying. Okay. So, all right, now I'm going to get into some of the early Choro composers and some examples of the music. Pull this out and see if I can get it to work. Okay. All right, so the reason why I want to talk about these Choro composers, because they all have different backgrounds, training, play different instruments, and also perform in different contexts. And they also, many of them publish music, but all from different, slightly different circumstances and in different, for different audiences, for different purposes. So I just want to highlight some of them. And so it's pretty interesting because there's no one route, you know, to this music. There's all these different channels in which a musician could cultivate these musical styles. So the first is Joaquim Galado. He was a virtuoso flutist. He was a composer. Many regard him as the first choro musician. He had this tenor ensemble called Choro Carioca. Carioca is a person from Rio, so the Rio Choro group, that would be. He wrote polcas and quadrilles, which are square dances, types of square dances. And so he adopted, you know, he called those pieces by those names, but when you listen to them, they don't necessarily sound that way. So his most well-known polka is this piece called Flor Amorosa. I'm going to play the beginning of that in 1 second. I just pulled this off the page there. Okay, so let's just pop this in. So in this piece, if this plays on its own, I don't know if it will, but this is, starts off with a terno ensemble. So we have the flute, guitar, and cavaquinho texture. Thank you. Now, let me pull this out for a second. And over here. Another musician I want to talk about, Anacleto de Medeiros. Okay. So he was a flutist. He played clarinet, sax, played all these instruments. He was a band leader. So he wrote for like brass and wind bands. And he was part of this fireman band, the Bandaji Bomberos, I think they're called. And he played in Choro de Choro, and you know, he's this great arranger. And he also incorporated the schottische rhythm. That was that kind of a slower version of the polka into his repertoire, often in like 4/4 time. And he took these schottisches, and then he also, you know, also incorporated a little bit of a swing feel into them, so they're interesting in terms of how they developed. So Anacleto de Medeiros, so he was, you know, performing, you know, this Brazilian music, and writing this Brazilian music for this different context, you know, than some of the other performers were writing for. He was also, his group, one of the first groups to ever record in Brazil. So some of the earliest Brazilian recordings are by his group and his arrangements. And there's some interesting things that result out of that. Let me play one of his pieces. I don't think I can play this one. I want to, but I think our internet connection is good enough. So I'm going to go back to this. And make sure I have the right track. This is called Santinha, or a little saint. Things that are going on during the early 20th century. pushing onward. Now, Shakina Gonzaga, a female composer. So, we're going to look at some new, different contexts in which music is cultivated, okay? So, she was a classically trained pianist and composer. She was born into an upper-class family, but then she, you know, got divorced, and it was all controversial and all this kind of stuff. She played in Choro, and it was the first to incorporate the piano into that setting. And one of her Choros, this Mishishi Kortajaka, is standard repertoire. It's like everybody that plays Choro knows this piece. It is something that she wrote for an operetta. And so she wrote a lot of pieces that had the new Choro sound and style for theater works. And they were popularized in the theatrical setting. People knew them there. And so then out of that popular setting, when they were played by Choro musicians, people knew them, they were familiar, and so that influence kind of led like that. Another thing that she did is she wrote some of the first carnival theme songs called marches back then. So they were marches, Brazilian marches. And she was known for that, and those pieces were also popularized as well. One thing about some of the compositions that were being written by various composers out of context is it sometimes took a while for them to be integrated, those pieces to be integrated into the main Choro repertoire. So it just, took time, but they're recognized. Let's see, going on here. Another composer, case in point, Ernesto Nazareth. So, he was a classically trained pianist. He was actually from a very, poor background, but he associated, his music with and targeted towards the upper class. He played in theaters and in salon settings. You guys know what salons are? Salons are like, kind of like this, like gatherings, where people, are interested in music and culture and, it can be poetry readings, whatever, usually, exclusive societies that can be big or small. They focus on music production, so music was cultivated throughout the 18th, 19th centuries in salon settings. It's usually upper class people, but anyone could really form a salon if they wanted to. So basically a society of people that were interested in arts and music, and then, they'd have these events, however, just depended on their who was involved in the organization, who was organizing it, and how much money they had, and then you have people performing all the time. So, interesting. So, Ernesto Nazareth wrote music for these settings. He was strongly, of course, influenced by Romantic period, classical music like Chopin, Liszt. So he wrote pieces that basically sound like early Choros, but he called them tango brasileiros, or Brazilian tangos. And part of the reason why he did that is because he didn't want the association with the mashishi in the poorer class, although his pieces are rhythmically identical to those pieces. He didn't want that association. And then he also wrote pieces called polcas and that. So his music was printed, it was marketed, but he never participated in the polcas. And it really wasn't until about the 1950s that Choro musicians started to play his pieces on a regular basis in the polcas. Now we're like, oh yeah, we play music by Ernesto Nazareth all the time, but it took a while for that to start happening. I'm gonna play one of his pieces so you can just get a sense of it.
Thank you.
contributing some of the earliest guitar pieces from the Brazilian style to the, not only to the Choro repertoire, but also to the classical guitar repertoire. And so his works kind of straddle this line between, as many of them do, as Ernest and as the rest works do, as Chiquinha Gonzaga's works do, between this kind of learned tradition and this popular tradition. And, you know, and that's never gone away in Brazilian music and culture, especially with Choro. So these are, you know, things that are being contemplated. So his works are these great virtuosic pieces for guitar, and you know, they also are majorly influential on the genre. Let's see if I can find the track below. So this is contributor to the repertoire, especially, but also the musical language. He contributed, I don't know how many pieces. I mean, I'm sure there are more than 100 pieces in the repertoire composed by him, so he's really significant in terms of that. And there's some other great musicians from the 20th century that also contributed, and these, you know, hopefully will be covered in further lectures. So, just to wrap up, I just want to say that Brazilian nationalism becomes even stronger by the 1920s, and choro becomes an important staple in terms of music that nationalist composers then want to integrate into their classical works or whatever art music that they're working on to kind of give a sense of national identity, national representation. Villa-Lobos is one of the, you know, well-known composers that did this and embraced choro a lot, and so this helped perpetuate the genre. And in choro music, some of the things that we've discussed have become tradition. The instrumentation, the form, the tunes, the rhythmic style, the musical vocabulary, all those types of things, the roda de choro, you know, that we saw at the beginning, you know, all those are traditional aspects, but then there are other aspects that are still developing. New musical currents are being integrated, certainly jazz, and new instruments, you name it. But then there are plenty of people, you know, just revisiting the traditional sound and style. You know, choro is this obligatory genre of music for people that really want to learn how to play Brazilian music. So people that really want to learn it, want to learn the heart of it, the core, the significance, study choro. So thank you for your attention, and I'll take any questions that you have. Anyone want to ask any questions? Yes, sir.
You said that modern musicians were classically trained.
Yes.
Do you mean that they came from conservatories or were they taking private lessons?
That depended, but some of the ones that I discussed went to conservatories or music institutions. Some of them even went to Europe to study. So those tended to be the melody players, the flutists, primarily, and the pianists, for sure. So yes, some of them that didn't have the resources then maybe studied with a teacher, like Ernesto Nazaré, for for example, studied with a teacher, you know, and studied that classical piano. Yeah. So it just varied. It was very case by case. But that influence was there. Meanwhile, the guitarists tended to just learn by ear, and few of them could read, you know, and let alone, you know, read music. Few of them could, you know, read, you know, words. You know, they're very. No, what's shocking is even by 1900, the literacy rate in Brazil was not even up to 20%. It just took them forever to get going with the institutionalization of education. And so at that point they started to do it, and then it was like, you know, by the 30s they really started to kick it in, but it's like all this, this social, stratification that came out of that never went away. It became a core reason for some of the problems in Brazil. But anyway, so that's that. Any other questions or thoughts? Anybody want to add anything? Something that you think would add to the discussion? Well, feel free afterward to come. Yes, sir?
Are there any other, I know Chiquinha is famous, are there any other female composers that you know of, or even musicians, or anyone, any prominent?
They were there, that's for sure, and they were
maybe
I can't
singers,
think of them
Maggio,
by name.
Maggio singers even, or
they were definitely singers, for sure, because Brazil was a place where singers and actors came through all the time, especially in Rio and any urban centers. They always had visiting singers and stuff, and so those singers would also go to like the bookstores. Like Paulo Brito was a mulatto publisher in Brazil in the mid-19th century, and his bookstore was like one of the main places where music was cultivated. And so the learned poets and all the performers, you know, the actresses and the opera singers, they'd hang out in his shop and then, you know, share this music. You know, the musicians would come too, and the poets would be there, and then they would be writing material and teaching it to the musicians, and then, you know, they go out and play it. So it was this really rich, you know, setting. So, yeah, I would think that there are, I just don't know offhand, you know. They're definitely, you know, women were important. Women were important leaders in society, too. And they became, especially the elite women, it became pretty unfashionable to be illiterate, though, by 1900. In Brazil. And so any, you know, upper crust woman in that society learned how to read, and they became the first teachers. So the women like really took charge of literacy. They had their own journals, and they, you know, had their own discussion in their own little societies. And so they were really important, and they became these really prominent leaders, and still are in Brazil. You know, so interesting thing there. So any other thoughts? Yes, sir.
I would like to add with the comment of leadership. Main leadership about the Chias Baianas.
Uh-huh.
Rio de Janeiro, a casa de Chias Baianas were address sometimes religious leadership in Rio de Janeiro that came to Rio de Janeiro, mostly from the Canudo School, also a civil war.
Yep.
And they started to form sort of paths of cultural council and doing short style. So I want to add to the discussion of.
Yeah. Yeah, so Chia literally means aunt, and they're like the head of this Afro-Brazilian religious organization. So they're like, in some cases, priestess of Candomblé or Umbanda or whatever. And then, like, one of the most famous Chias was Chia Chiap, and she hung out with Choro musicians. She had parties at her house, and the Choro musicians would come, and she was respected, you know, in Rio, and you know, they would hang out there. But yeah, but they were these cultural, center points, you know, for a lot of reasons. And so in that, you get this African, you know, religious influence, you know, as part of the culture, because all the, you know, the people that, the family members, the friends, were practitioners of those religions. And then you also have Choro in other styles of popular music being cultivated there, and that's where you get a lot of the mixing. It's a good point. Thank you for bringing that up. That's another, yeah, something that could integrate into this. A very good point. Any other questions, thoughts? Yes, sir?
So, I forget the name of it, but the Portuguese salon music that you were talking about?
Mogi. They existed before the book.
Okay.
Yeah, so they were, you know, genres that were older in style. And then, yeah, so they were kind of a little before that. Yeah. Did you have a question?
I did, about to add to Martina, when Catulo da Paixão Siriense takes the tunes from Anacoleto and changes them to Marginha. Were those two composers alive at the same time?
Yes.
How did each one view what he was doing? And how popular was Marginha when it was at its heyday?
Okay, so Cia Renzi and Anacleto de Medeiros, they were friends, although Anacleto died like in 1907. So not for long, you know, but they were friends. And so I think Cia Renzi set at least a dozen, if not more, of his pieces to Edmogenius. So he was in agreement with it. He was fine with it. And so he just took his pieces and then changed them. Of course, the whole, you know, authorship attribution thing was a little loose during that time. During that time period. So that's what, and then the second part was?
How popular was Marginha?
Yeah. So Marginha was declining in popularity by 1900. Another thing that was happening in Rio was the Belle Époque. This is the height of the French cultural movement in Brazil. So I already said it was stronger in the 19th century. Well, it got really strong from about 1898 to about 1914. And Cianese was at the core of that. You know, he was part of that environment. And so he was trying to renovate the Marginha during that time. So he was cranking out lots of Marginhas, but with this erudite, you know, high flung poetry with strong French influences in it, like major, you know, like intense lyrics. And some of the early Choros have some of those lyrics, some of that influence in it. And this was just before he went into the Northeastern regional identity phase that he was in. He played with João Pernambuco, the composer of the last guitar piece. So those two got together because they were both from the Northeast, and then they started this band together, and they started playing all this Northeastern music, Northeastern Brazilian music, and dressed up in all this Northeastern Brazilian garb. And, you know, it really started to popularize it. And Northeastern music was being popularized already, partly because of the War of the Canudos. There was this war in the late 1800s, and this author named Euclides da Cunha was a reporter, and he wrote about the War of the Canudos, and he published it in the newspapers, you know, in the installments. And that was the way people read things back, you know, back then. It was in the newspaper because it was affordable, and then you read it in sections, and you'd even, you know, various types of literature were done that way. But him doing that popularized and romanticized Northeastern Brazilian culture, so we start to see it being integrated and popularized. And then what happens? It starts to be integrated into popular music, and then by extension, short. So they start to, in the 20s, they start to get some of that influence. And it's already in, you know, Pernambuco's music, and his guitar playing and everything, so interesting stuff there. Any other questions or comments? Yes?
You mentioned a little bit about the salon, and then you also mentioned that, like, the lead composer worked in operetta.
Uh-huh.
So I'm just wondering about venues. Were there nice opera houses? But I don't imagine that would go to the Choro would be having room there. Where would the venues be?
So, like, during the Belle Époque, there was an opera house built in Rio. So Rio was gutted, just like Paris was. And all the poor people were told to leave. That's why the, you know, all these hillside communities developed in Rio. But and they modeled it on Paris, and they built an opera house. And so there was opera being performed there, but there were also theaters all over the place. And so and Shakespeare was big, and, you know, then, you know, comedy or variety acts like operetta and stuff like that. And smaller theater settings were really popular and common. So people went to them. That was the entertainment, especially for the urban folks. So it was very common, very popular. There are many venues for it, and lots of audience for it too. And so composers had to write for that. And so many of the, you know, throughout the history, like the look at the musicians in the 19th century who sang Marginhas and lundus, whether they were composers, performers, they also performed in some of those settings. You know, it was like professional singers. Some of them did, some didn't. It just depends. So there's this mixed background, again, you know, that musicians were involved in. So that's good. Yeah, another good point too about, you know, the culture at the time. So pretty interesting. Okay, any other questions or comments or anything that anybody wants to add to that? Well, thank you for all those questions and comments. Those are really good. Those really added to the topic and the discussion. So appreciate that. And thank you for coming and thank you for your attention. One will be virtual, but they're on our program, so visit our website to get more information. The other two will be here, and we want to do a final, not exactly part of this lecture series, but we're going to have a Choro presentation playing music, so look forward to that. We're going to do it sometime in December.